Super Talk Studios. Joining us now, Mr. Lars Larson, nationally syndicated talk host. Of course, host of the Lars Larson Show here on Super Talk Mississippi, 6 o'clock weekdays. Lars, it is an honor and a pleasure, sir, to have you on the program today. Thanks for joining us.
Hey, it's a pleasure to be on the program. I just heard your comments about these competitive measures where government that doesn't know how to do anything particularly well is going to show the private sector how to do competition. And one thing that caught my ear, if you don't mind me getting a little inside baseball, you were talking about this effort against so-called no-competes. I don't know if that was at the top of your list, but I have personal experience with no-competes because for most of my career, I've had no-competes. And I've had endless numbers of people call the show and say, this isn't fair to have a no-compete agreement. I said, well, you don't have to make the agreement, number one. It's a mutual thing. And number two, it makes you more valuable. And people have said, well, what do you mean by that? Now, you know that in broadcast, when I worked in TV and I've worked in radio, if your boss comes to you and says, I want you to sign a contract, you can say, no, I'd rather work month to month. I'll go paycheck to paycheck. That's fine. If he says, I want to sign you to a contract, but I want to no-compete, for people outside the broadcast business, the dirty little secret is you could be 10 years at one TV station, build up, you know, from zero to a big reputation locally for being a good reporter or good news anchor. And then all of a sudden you take all that reputation, which was part you and part the TV station, because they had a role in that, and say, I'd like to take that valuable thing and take it across town and sell it to your competitor for more money. And when the boss says, I don't want you to do that, he signs you to a no-compete. And as I said, you can say no. If you ban no-competes, and there have been state efforts to do this, state legislative efforts, if you do that, you're making the employee less valuable because somebody could say, well, and I know you really don't, Super Talk really doesn't have any competition in Mississippi. You dominate the state. But let's say somebody was on Super Talk for 8 or 10 or 20 years and then says, hey, you know what? Now that I've got a huge name in the state and I didn't have one when I first went to work here, I'm going to go sell it. You say, well, that's you. No, it's not you. It's a partnership between you and Super Talk. And if you want to go across town and sell it to the competitors to Super Talk, does that strike anybody as a fair kind of arrangement? So I'm a fan of no-competes. Yes, they can crimp your style from time to time, but frankly, they make workers more valuable and they make employers more secure. And what employer would want to say, I want to build this man or woman up, or these days they, if they're a they, I guess there are some theys. I don't know how many are in broadcast right now. But if you say, I'm going to build this person up, and I'm going to buy billboards, I'm going to promote them, I'm going to send them out to events, and then when they've got a big old reputation, they're going to take it across town and sell it to my competitor. Who wants to work in that? Who wants to employ people in a situation like that?
Yeah, it's a great point, and thanks so much for sharing the analogy, I guess, to the broadcast industry. Lars, I come from the IT industry. And in the IT industry, these are very common because the demand for talent is exceedingly higher than the supply. And we hire these folks, we pay them an unbelievable amount of money because they're valuable. And then what do we do? We train them, we give them incredible resources and assets so they can go make unbelievable livings. and they do that, of course, on their accord, but they can't do it without the partnership and being part of our team and the resources and the assets we surround them with. And then they say, okay, I got it. I'm going over here and I'm taking all my customers and all my assets and all my information and, you know, this gazillion-dollar quote I'm working on, I'm going to go over here and just sell it working for those guys. So is it just an agreement between employees and employers? And yep. It's not the government's place to meddle in that. I don't know if you caught it, but it just feels like they want to dictate who we hire, how much we pay them, how many days off we give them, what their benefits are going to be. And then they want to dictate what you're going to sell, who you're going to sell it to it, and at what price you're going to sell. Well, then what do they need me for? They become the industry. This is what disturbs me.
Well, and it disturbs me too, and it should disturb every working man and woman and every business owner out there, because imagine this, say you have a really valuable employee, and say in IT, you want to hire this person, and you say, but this person really values time off. They want to go hunting every fall for 3 months. You say, okay, I'll give you more time off, but that means I have to pay you less. Or you could go the other way around. Could be a young man or woman who says, I've got a new family, I've got a house, I want to make the maximum amount of money, I don't want all the time off, I need the money in my bank account. And I think all of us have been at that point in our lives where you said time off wasn't valuable, because when you had time off, you didn't have any money to go do anything with it. So you say, I'd rather be working and making money to get myself situated for the future. And then later in life, you might say, I'd like more time off. And you negotiate those things. And here's the government walking in saying, we know what's best for both of you. We will negotiate on your behalf, and you don't have any say-so in it. That is intruding into your affairs every bit as much as Joe Biden's plan to have door knockers asking about vaccination.
We've been talking about that, too. But what you just described there, Lars, is this concept of delayed gratification, which has now been deemed racist. You can't work hard today and sacrifice today for some reward in the future. Oh, no, that's racist.
Well, anyway, isn't that crazy? I got an email this week from a guy. I don't know him, but he said, look, Lars, I've been swinging a hammer my whole life. And he says, I've done very well at it. And he says, and at age 23, I was paying all my bills. I bought my first house. At age 25, I bought another house. And he says, now I've got 15 rentals. And so he's built up. If you think about that, if you buy houses in your 20s and by your 40s, they're mostly paid for and they're worth a lot more. And he says, along comes the government and says, by the way, and he says he's one of the victims, three of his 11 tenants have not been paying rent for a year because the government decided you don't have to pay rent. So they've intruded into a private relationship. And, you know, the left will always tell you about one particular private relationship, and that is between a woman and her doctor and her ability to kill unborn babies. And they love that kind of stay out of my business. But when it comes to saying, I bought a house 20 years ago, I've worked hard on it, I've treated my tenants right, and then you walk in and tell them they don't have to uphold their end of the deal. Who are you to walk in and tell me what to do? And yet they've done that to literally hundreds of thousands of landlords. And I know that many people, when they think of landlord, I'm old enough, I remember the old Snidely Whiplash cartoons, you know, the guy with the long mustache.
I do too.
And, I'll get you, my pretty. And but most landlords, an awful lot of landlords in America, and I bet this is true in Mississippi, are mom and pops. They're a husband and wife or a couple who bought a house and then bought another one and spent decades building up a stock of rental housing. And I had a duplex for about 10 years. I treated my tenants very well, and I had a great relationship with them. And there was one tenant in particular, Emmett Turner. He'd fall behind a couple of months because he had quit a really good job with the city working in the road department to turn wood projects. So he had kind of a feast or famine existence. There were months he'd sell a couple of big, you know, projects he'd worked on for a client, and he'd make a bunch of money, and then he'd be short of cash. So I let him float because we had a good relationship. Who is the government to get in the middle of my good relationship and say, you have to treat everybody like you treated Emmett? Well, I trusted Emmett, and Emmett never failed to come through for me. But other people, I wouldn't have trusted them past, you know, 5 days late.
Sure. But they're on your property. They're using your assets. To some degree, you got to have some rights, but the government says, no, you can't do that. It's just essentially denying your right to work is what it is. It's exactly what it is, because that is your work, essentially. What bothers me about the president just signing an executive order, and the report I read says 72 provisions. I haven't read them all, but I've read a few. And what's laughable in the irony, Lars, is that they're designed to combat anti-competition. The government is going to step in and fight anti-competition. That never works out. And they always say, we're just going to limit it to these few industries. That never works out either.
Well, I'll tell you what. Can I give you one place the government could increase competition to the benefit of all? Now, I don't want to be hated by letter carriers, because we have a lot of great letter, you do and I do, a lot of great letter carrier listeners. My beef is with their management. But do you know one place where there is an absolute monopoly? And that is first-class mail.
There
is actually a set of laws that says that if Lars or, you know, Gerard goes out and says, I'm going to set up a private business delivering letters to people's businesses because I can do it faster in my town in Mississippi. It is actually illegal, and the post office has gone after people and prosecuted them for violating that law. So they granted this first-class monopoly. Postal Service used to earn about 85%
of its revenue. Hey, Lars, hold that thought. We got a break. Let's continue it when we come back after the break. I got a couple of other things to ask you about, too. Lars Larson is our guest. Stay with us, everybody. The JT Show. Mississippi, Lars Larson is our guest. Lars, thanks so much for hanging on. So please continue. You were making a great point about the monopoly that is the United States Postal Service.
Well, people may not realize it, but first-class mail is legally restricted to only the post office. Now, they're losing a lot of money. First-class mail is kind of going away because of technology and bill payment and everything else. But having said that, if he wants to make them competitive, force the post office to compete. I'm not sure that UPS or FedEx or the others would want to deliver first-class mail. But the idea that you have a money-losing $10 billion a year in losses, U.S. Postal Service, again, my beef is with management, not with the carriers, that has a monopoly on mail. Why should the government have the monopoly on any kind of service? And when people say, well, the Constitution provides for the Postal Service, it says you can have one. It doesn't say you have to have one. And at this point, I hate to say it, but the post office losing $10 billion a year while FedEx and UPS make tons of money because they do a very good job at it. Let's put some competition in there, Joe. Just call the Postal Board of Directors and say, why don't we have some competition there?
Yeah, totally agree. And you reminded me of something with respect to a board of directors where we've got states already, such as California and Illinois, that are dictating what the composition of a board of directors is to be. You've even got what the NASDAQ, I believe, considering provisions and rules that would require certain compositions of boards of directors to be listed, to be public. So this is just more, again, central planning when you start talking about this is what your board has to look like, the organization responsible for governing the organization itself. That just doesn't make any sense.
No, it doesn't. And worse than that, imagine the person who's put on a board of directors and realizes they are the minority hire.
Yeah.
And I think we should be that blunt about it because, you know, I don't follow football as much as many people do, but the Rooney Rule, are you familiar with that? If they're going to interview coaches, they've got to interview one person of color for the coaching job. So somewhere in America, there's a coach who may be a very good coach. And he realizes he's the Rooney Rule add to the list, and he's going to be interviewed, and they're going to treat him just like the other ones. And he may or may not get the job, probably won't. There aren't too many black coaches in the NFL, and I'd love to see more of them. But I'd love to see them get there based on their skills and their talents and their record, not because you say, oh, great, I've got to go to this set of interviews. I know they're not going to hire me, and I'm being included because of my skin color. That's got to feel like the biggest insult in the world.
I could agree more, but Lars, this is something we talk about on the program a lot that deeply concerns me is this push by the left to transition this country from an achievement-based society to one where outcomes are determined, just as you were discussing, based on your physical attributes. That just can't work out in our best interest. And how can a person, as you said, that is selected, let's say, for admission to a school or for a job or for appointment to a board solely based on their physical attributes, their identity, if you will, as opposed to their performance, their value proposition, that can't produce the best for society?
No, and imagine, ask, I have not served in the military, most of my family members have, but ask anybody who's served, and I've put this question to people who have prior service and are veterans or are currently serving, and they'll tell you, that they'll make the point that we should all be aware of, the military began desegregating a long time before American society did, and at that point, the military became a meritocracy. Now, we can probably find examples where it failed. But there are a lot of cases where you go in as a young man or woman, black or white or Hispanic, and if you're really good, you end up as a sergeant, a lieutenant, a captain, or you end up as Colin Powell, as the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and you end up working for a president of the United States. And your skin color didn't matter. What mattered was you knew how to do the job. Now, take that kind of meritocracy and then apply the rules the Biden administration wants to apply to everything else and say, we want the military to have a colorful rainbow of all these various checkmark boxes that you have to check. So you say, you're going to get a sergeant. He's not a very good sergeant or he's not a very good lieutenant, but he's the right gender, he's the right pronoun, he's the right sexual preference, or he's the right color, or she's the right color, and so we're going to put him in charge. Can you imagine how demoralizing that would be when people say, yeah, my captain isn't very bright, he sent us on some really bad, made some really bad decisions, but he checked all the right boxes to make Uncle Joe happy.
Well, in that case, people die. I mean, literally, this is what happens. Those are the consequences. Yeah. And you look no further than Biden's cabinet. I mean, you know, that was just a chessboard they laid out, said we got to have one of these, one of those, one of these. It had nothing to do with capability or qualifications.
And you know, when you look at past presidents, too, Obama, for example, one of the measures I'd never seen before Obama was what percentage of the time in years has have your cabinet members spent in the private sector? And most presidents have, you know, cabinet members who've been in academics or business or both. And many times the percentages are very high for private sector experience. The private sector is not afraid to punish you if you don't, you know, perform. Obama took that down to 8%. His entire cabinet, 8% of their entire experience had been in the private sector. The rest of them were college professors talking theory in a classroom. Well, as we all know, universities are great, but the problem is theory in a classroom sometimes does not work at all when the rubber meets the road.
That is just unbelievable. So wanted to also ask you about, we just had July 4th, Independence Day in America.
Yep.
I don't know that I've ever seen so many just across our society, those in government, Maxine Waters, Cori Bush, denouncing this country, calling it out, highly critical of it. You got major media outlets, the Washington Post, NPR, who says a Declaration of Independence is racist. The Washington Post says the Statue of Liberty has got to be canceled, that it's hypocritical. The New York Times says the flag is divisive. But you can't get them to say, well, where is it better, first of all? And secondly, it was the idea was to aspire to create and establish a more perfect union. Nobody ever said it was perfect, but it's excellent is the way I describe it.
Well, and I think we were a country created by geniuses who wrote, as you said, an aspirational document. And it's the same way most of us who are, you know, if you said to your kids, what do you want to do? And the kid's 21 or 22, and he said, exactly what I'm doing right now, Dad, for the rest of my life. You say, you don't aspire to anything? Now, if the kid has asked, I want to be an astronaut. I want to be a nuclear physicist. Good. Maybe you won't get all the way there, but, heck, who said this? A man's reach should exceed his grasp, or what's a heaven for? And what he meant was, at every point in your life, even when you get older, you should be saying, you know what, next year I'm going to learn some things, or tomorrow I'm going to learn some things. I'm going to know how to do things next month, next year, that I didn't know how to do today. And can you imagine the sad state of a human if you said, I'm happy with what I know now, with what I do now, I don't aspire to do anything better. When you're a country, if you have an aspirational document that says, this is what we hope to be, and we know we are not that today. I had a historian point out to me the other day, do you know that at least a couple of the original 13 colonies tried to outlaw slavery at the time America was being formed, as they were becoming states? And people say, oh, no, America was just irredeemably racist. No, there were a couple of the colonies that tried to outlaw it at the time. And clearly the Constitution aspired to the idea that we are all created equal and that we all have equal rights under the law. Now, why would you write a document that just says whatever we're doing right now is okay, status quo, we're going to stick with that? This and going back and criticizing it because the fact that they wrote a document that wasn't being reflected at that time, but that the colonies and the founders said this is where we want this country to go, and it's where we've gone.
But isn't it that document that facilitated that, essentially?
Yes. And there isn't another document like it on planet Earth. And like you, I love to ask people who say, America is terrible. I say, great, name a better country. even our ideological cousins in places like Canada and Great Britain do not have the, and I think many Americans must be unaware of this, don't have the freedoms we have. Because you can go to Canada and be convicted for free speech. Mark That's Stein, right. one of our colleagues, very nearly got, he was put on trial for free speech that was critical of Islam. In Great Britain, there are no Second Amendment rights. There are no First Amendment rights. Well, there are limited First Amendment rights. But there is no place on earth that affords its citizens the kind of freedoms we have. But better than that, the only country on earth that says these freedoms don't come because a government apparatchik gave them to you. They came because of God. God gave you those rights. The government's job is to protect it.
Well, we got to go, but the left would tell you that your rights come from government. They don't acknowledge that there's such a thing as unalienable rights from your creator. We can't even get past that. Lars, I can't tell you what a joy it's been to have you on the program. So appreciative of you joining us today. Enjoy your program, and it was a lot of fun. Take care, sir. Thank you.
It is always my pleasure to be on. And by the way, my newest dog, who just celebrated his 11th month birthday, he's a Bernese. He came from Pontotoc. So I'm always grateful to Mississippi for my puppy dog.
Pontotoc, Mississippi. Very cool. Lars, take care. Thanks a lot.
Take care now.
We'll be right back. Stay with us.